Bolinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Fish Tales, written and read by Paul Salmon. Be sure to visit our website at www.bolinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Bolinda Audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording.
Dedication. To everyone involved in our great game of Aussie rules, we all have our stories to tell and our lives have all been enriched by the game. And remember, what goes on the trip stays on the trip, but what makes it into the book is worth a look. This book would not have been completed without the support and commitment of writer extraordinaire Brad McKenzie. Thank you, Brad, for all your help and for applying your unique style to what was originally a bottomless pit of mumbo jumbo. You brought so many experiences to life as only you could do. You're a good mate, and a cheap one. Love to Jane and Daniel. I'm sure they've had to put up with a bit during this process. Thank you to everyone I've come into contact with throughout a long and unforgettable life in football. The players, the administrators, the support staff, and, of course, the fans. You have all contributed to the person I am and the memories I have. A very big thanks to the team at Penguin, in particular Katie Purvis and Bob Sessions, for their support and patience. It's been a wonderful experience working with you, and I've appreciated the opportunity to document some of the special moments from my football career. Last but not least, thanks to my wife Jo and kids Leah, Lachlan and Sean. You guys are my world, and football has been a big part of our lives. Thank you for your love and support through another book, a business life, a media career, and, believe it or not, a comeback. I promise things will settle down, a little, eventually. Introduction. For my first training session at the Essendon Football Club, I was 15 years old. I was waiting for my turn to do a run so they could test my fitness when a very big, hairy man, who looked to me to be aged about 40, sat down next to me. In fact, it was an 18-year-old, 6'10", Justin Madden. He advised me that I was exceptionally tall, like him. I didn't need to worry too much about the fitness test. Running wasn't important, and come to think of it, neither was marking. And while we were at it, kicking wasn't a big issue either. The only thing we big fellas had to know how to do was tap the ball to the advantage of our teammates. This was called ruck work. When Justin told me this, it occurred to me that one of us surely wasn't going to make it, and my money was on him. But the old adage of football being a funny game is very true, and of course, he not only made it, but played 330-plus games that included premierships and All-Australian selection. I learned a couple of valuable lessons as a consequence of that encounter. That other blokes started shaving much earlier than me, and I should never prejudge anybody on how they talked, but rather should assess them on their actions. The suggestion from my friends at Penguin that I record some of my favourite memories appealed to me, because I've always believed that you get the most fun and enjoyment from memories by sharing them. What follows is a collection of stories about various happenings and events from my 20-odd years as a player at both the Essendon and Hawthorn football clubs. A football career is full of challenges and tests of character, but it's also full of people and experiences you wouldn't trade for anything. That's if you have the good fortune to survive in that rewarding, yet very unforgiving, environment called a footy club. Football clubs are amazing places when you consider the huge numbers of people involved and the daily interaction between them. Clubs become the setting for extraordinary occurrences, some of which are destined to be swept under the carpet in the best interests of the individuals involved and the club. Others of which are regularly repeated and exaggerated to ensure the ongoing embarrassment of those who took part. When you think about it, players do so much personal stuff together. We party, travel, shower, train, share deodorant, carpool, dine out, go to each other's weddings, and get together with each other's families, to name just a few activities. Our teammates are almost like blood relatives, but without the DNA connection. And as everyone knows, you can't choose your family, but you can choose your friends. I feel lucky and privileged to have experienced a life as a footballer. The game has shaped me and helped make me who I am today. It has provided me with so many great memories that, when I thought about it, it seemed selfish to keep them all to myself. So welcome to an album of snapshots of my life in football. By bringing together some yarns, both humorous and otherwise, I hope to give you an idea of what makes me tick. Now, that's if you don't allow the truth to get in the way of a good story. Water bottles. When I first started to play football, the longest trip the team ever had to make was to Geelong. We would drive down in our own car, get a ride with a mate, or go on the team bus. Regardless of how we arrived, it was at most a 1.5 hour trip. With so many interstate games now, it seems we fly to games more often than we drive. I enjoy flying. It's great to let someone else have the worry of getting you there. However, some of the guys aren't the best flyers. We were once at the airport when an announcement came over that due to a mechanical problem, our flight would be delayed for an hour. One player, who has a reputation as a tough man, nearly had to be tranquilised to get on the flight once it was right to go. And that was only after the stewards got the captain to reassure him that everything would be okay. I think it's funny when people whinge about flight delays due to mechanical failure. My philosophy is, take your time and get it right. Don't worry about me, I'll wait. Don't rush, just in case you miss something. Take it for a test run if you like. Without a doubt, the worst trip we have to take is to Perth. 4 hours cooped up in your seat can take its toll. I can't imagine how bad it is for my colleagues in economy. To stop dehydration, we're given a 1.25 litre bottle of still water, which we have to finish before the end of the flight. On one occasion, I discovered that my bottle of water had quite a few bubbles in it. Halfway through the trip, one of my teammates came to sit next to me. How he got through the curtain that separates economy from business, I'll never know. But anyway, he sat down. I pointed out the bubbles in my water. It occurs to me that you're probably thinking, wow, Fish must be a boring person to say, hey, look at the bubbles in my water. I'm not. I have a lot of interest, as anyone who has seen my collection of potato chips that look like Liberal leaders will tell you. Anyway, my teammate asked, how does that happen? And you thought I needed to get a life. Well, I said, this is what happens when you fly. Above 30,000 feet, water self-carbonates. On a flight as long as this, you can end up with a bottle of sparkling mineral water. It's amazing stuff. Science has been baffled by it for years. Really? Oh, yes, I replied, warming to my story and making it all up as I went along. Overseas flights have strict safety procedures. After 4 hours, all bottles of water have to be returned to the stewards, who uncap them and pour them down the sink, just in case there is too much self-carbonation. They could explode. Something like that could take a plane out of the sky. You're joking. Look, can I grab your bottle and show a few of the others? Oh, sure. He took off back to his seat and I could see him retelling the story of the miracle of self-carbonation. Many of the guys looked at me for confirmation and I nodded and winked to let them in on the gag. It turned out that due to a malfunction on another plane at Perth Airport, which consequently blocked the runway, our plane was held in a flight pattern about 100 kilometres out of Perth, circling for 2 hours. Most of us had no problem with this. It wasn't our flight that had the drama. Everything was okay, and we weren't playing until the next day. We accepted our fate and relaxed. Short of having a parachute, we couldn't really do much about it anyway. Games of cards were started, magazines were read, and time dragged on, as it does in these situations. We'd been in the air for about 5 hours or so when I heard a boing sound 2 seats behind me. It was my unquestioning self-carbonation friend ringing for the steward, who came up and said, can I help you? Yes, can you tell me what height we're at? Certainly about 33,000 feet. And this flight has been going now for 4.5 hours? Yes, sir, but we have plenty of fuel and our flight crew are very, very experienced. What about the water? Sorry? The water? We have plenty. Would you like some? No, the self-carbonation. I'm not sure what you mean, sir. My friend then proceeded to explain the theory of self-carbonation, saying that we had been in the air for well over 4 hours and why hadn't the staff collected the water to avert what could be a tragedy? Half the team had now stopped what they were doing to watch what was going on. The steward replied that he hadn't heard of this ever happening in any way. It would mean that on an overseas flight, every bottle of water would have to be tipped out after 4 hours. Furthermore, what about soft drinks and beer? Not to mention the water in the taps and the bathrooms. My self-carbonation theory had been shot down in flames. By now, those within earshot were just about wetting their pants. Although that could have been because we'd all drunk a stack of water. Eventually, we landed in Perth, and as we made our way off the plane, the steward thanked us for flying with the airline, and especially thanked my teammate for looking after the safety and well-being of the passengers and the crew on the flight. This, of course, was met with more laughter. The next day, we were all in the change rooms going through our individual pre-game rituals. I unzipped my bag to get my gear out, and everything was soaking wet. Boots, shorts, jumper, the lot. My teammate turned to me and said, a water bottle must have self-carbonated on the bus trip in, Fish. Apparently it can happen. It took me a week and numerous generous applications of calamine lotion to get rid of the chafing from my playing in a wet jockstrap. Windy. I was 15 years old when I first trained at Essendon. I'd get a taxi to the ground for training, which is an experience in itself. I'd come out of school and the taxi, booked by the club, would be waiting for me. Ever the scammer, I would have the driver take a few mates of mine who lived in the area home first. My mates didn't realise the club was paying for the cab, so I'd offer to pay whatever the fare was to their house. Being a big noter, I'd say, "Look, it's not really out of my way, so just give me half. That'll be fine." They didn't have to walk home, and I made a few dollars. Everybody was happy. Being at school and training 3 nights a week took its toll, so by Thursday, I would be starting to feel a bit tired. Friday afternoons quite often saw me just telling the cab driver my destination, Windy Hill, Essendon, and then falling asleep and having the driver wake me when we got there. One Friday, I jumped in the taxi, said to the driver, "Windy Hill," made myself comfortable and dozed off. I woke up about an hour and a half later. The taxi had stopped and the driver was out of the car. I peered through the window and saw him leaning on the bonnet, looking into the distance. I gathered my senses, hopped out and said, "Well, what's going on?" He replied in broken English, "I bring you Windy Hill. Are you asleep? I couldn't wake." I looked around and we were on the top of Mount Dandenong at the Observatory restaurant. The driver was just smiling at me and nodding his head. Technically, I guess it was a Windy Hill. It just wasn't the Windy Hill. I've never slept in a cab since. Last rites. One of the nicest guys I've met through football is Tony Bahadja. He's a fabulous guy who was great around the Essendon Club, a born leader to whom people were naturally drawn. We got on very well. My first overseas end-of-season trip was to Noumea. It was my first overseas trip anywhere, so I was very excited. At the airport before we left, I found myself in the duty-free area with Budgie and Anton Grabak, and we decided to grab some alcohol. As much duty-free alcohol as we possibly could. I bought scotch, Budgie got Bundaberg rum, and Anton picked up Bacardi. As you can see, we were sophisticated drinkers. The grand plan was hatched that we would pull the grog on our arrival in Noumea. After a couple of days in the sun, we decided it was time to bring out the bottles and settled in with the scotch to start. The bottle was dispatched in fairly quick time, as were the problems of the world. We solved them all. No problem was too large, no drama too small for the three blokes into the duty-free scotch. When the last drop was drained from the bottle, Tony took it and suggested we give it a decent burial. That bottle, he declared, had brought us much happiness, and we would be a lot sadder for its passing. We agreed. Well, if the truth be known, Johnny Walker agreed and we went along with him. Tony removed a plant from a nearby pot, dug a hole and buried the bottle, then replaced the plant. We all stood with our heads bowed for about a minute or two before moving on to the next bottle. Bundy, if I remember correctly. We took our time over this bottle, appreciating it as connoisseurs would a fine drop of red. All the while we spoke about, well, pretty much nothing, to be perfectly honest. We had our drinking shoes on and the crap was flying about as quickly as Bundaberg's finest. Eventually the bottle was finished and again Budgie suggested a decent burial and we agreed. By this time we would have agreed to ride a horse naked in the Sydney Mardi Gras parade. Never a shrinking violet, Budgie invited the people in the bar area to join us as he walked outside. About 20 people gathered in the forecourt to watch Budgie scale the downpipe onto the roof of the bar with the empty Bundy bottle. It's amazing how you rarely injure yourself when drunk. I've seen men fall from roofs onto the ground and just shake their heads, brush themselves off, and walk away. On the other hand, I've seen sober people step off a gutter and break their ankle. There's no doubt that alcohol does lead you to make foolish decisions. How many times have you read in the paper about some bloke killed by a bear at the zoo? And as the story unfolds, it's revealed by the police that he was under the influence of alcohol. I read somewhere that the US Congress wanted to put labels on alcohol that said, "Warning, drinking alcohol while pregnant can harm your unborn child." I thought at the time, how ironic, because if it weren't for alcohol, there probably wouldn't be so many pregnancies. Anyway, Budgie, protected by the alcohol angel, got up on the roof with the empty bottle and laid it in the gutter. Then he addressed the crowd, extolling the virtues of that particular bottle, how it stuck with him during the hard times, been his friend, and he doubted there would ever be another like it. The crowd was swept up with the solemnity of the situation and stood with their heads bowed. Budgie got down and the drinking started again. It went on all night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.